All right, let's stand. As you're here for our worship, we'll take our offering up. Brother Weber, you want to give us a hand tonight? They come. Who's singing? Judy singing? All right. All right. Let me get this one here. All right. As she comes, Brother Weber, would you ask the blessing, please?
Thank you. Have you been to... No, no, go on. To Jesus for the cleansing power. Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in His grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Oh, are you washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you walking daily by the Savior's side? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Do you rest each moment in the crucified? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Oh, are you washed stained with sin? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Oh, there's a fountain flowing for the soul unclean. Oh, be washed in the blood of the Lamb. Oh, are you washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
Amen. Give the Lord a hand as you're seated tonight.
Savannah, are you going to sing?
Where's she at?
Come on, come sing. Come on. You can think of something.
Jesus loves the little children, all the children of the world. Red, brown, yellow, black, and white, they are precious in His sight. Jesus loves the little children of the world. Jesus died for all the children, all the children of the world. Red, brown, yellow, black, and white, they are precious in His sight. Jesus died for all the children of the world.
Amen. Give her a hand. Hey, now that's being instant, ain't it? Huh? That's being instant. She didn't look too happy at first. It's all right. I don't like it when people do that to me either when I go someplace. Amen. Glad to be in the house of the Lord tonight. We're going to open tonight to the book, 2 Thessalonians. Read a couple of verses. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. And let's see, I'll read probably the first three. And we'll go back and see what the Lord has for us tonight. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. Verse 1 says, "Now we beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and by our gathering together unto Him, that ye be not soon shaken in mind or be troubled, neither by spirit nor by word nor by letter, as from us, as that the day of Christ is at hand. Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come, except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition. Let's all say amen to God's word tonight, and we'll back up verse 1 there, where it says, we beseech you, and that word, if you look at it, means got a couple of different meanings, to beg, to implore, or to persuade. It's a strong, very strong word. And, you know, kids growing up, you know, they have a lot of pressure on them. I was thinking about this before we come over. And, you know, people and Satan as well, you know, he will try his best, you know, in his own way. And people will try in their own way to beseech you. Satan will try in his own way to beseech you. And you know, like I was saying, kids have a lot of pressure on them today, you know, and what they call peer pressure. And they'll try their best. And like I said, that word means to beg or to persuade. And I got thinking how many kids' lives get shaped by being persuaded to do the wrong thing. Amen. Having the wrong kind of pressure put on them to do this or do that, or tell them, hey, if you don't do this, we're going to do that. If you don't say this or go along with this, well, then you're going to be on the outs and you're not going to be on the ends. And, you know, it's a hard, hard thing that they're growing up in today. It really is. And it's been like that for a long time. And a lot of the things that they do and a lot of the decisions that they make, that they are beseeched or that they are persuaded to make, oftentimes shapes how the rest of their life is going to play out, amen? And then when you get grown up, listen, it's still the same things. It's still patterns. And how many of you know patterns just tend to repeat themselves over and over and over and over again, even in us as children of God, amen? But I believe tonight we've got to find a way, amen, to break that pattern, amen, and break that old cycle and break that bad cycle, amen, and get something better, get a new pattern, and get a better cycle, amen. And it all starts with coming to the house of God, amen. It all starts with a daily walk with the Lord, amen. How many of us over the years, we started out strong, but along the way, amen, life got in the way, things got in the way, situations got in the way, people got in the way, and little by little, amen, Satan started to pluck away and tear away at your prayer life, amen, and started to tear down your reading and your study and devotion time with God. But we've got to find our way back, amen, to what it used to be and to what it should be, amen, because there is a rapture, amen, I believe with all of my heart that we need to get ready for. And let me tell you something, it is an imminent event. It's not if it's going to happen, but it's when it's going to happen, amen. Throw your hands up tonight, praise God, if you still believe that Jesus is coming back after a blood wash and a blood-bought church tonight, amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. We beseech you. And you know, Satan has a lot of ways to try to persuade people into doing the wrong thing, turning the wrong way, and living the wrong way. And make no mistake, we are in that time. I was reading something the other day, and I don't know if people really understand sometimes the magnitude of what they're saying or their thought process, but I was reading something the other day, and It was along the lines of, you know, and when I hear stuff, and, you know, just like you folks also as well, when you hear something that's going on, right away my mind goes to the Word of God and the Scriptures. That's just the way we're programmed. Amen? When you see something going on in the news or something going on over in the Holy Lands, right away we think about the Word of God because that's what's in us. Amen? And that's what we're looking for. And I heard something the other day where somebody was saying, hey, we are, right now we're being persuaded to call evil good and good evil. And it hit me. I was like, do they really understand what they're saying or what they're talking about? They are fulfilling the Scriptures right in front of us, and they don't even realize, amen, what they are walking through and what they're saying. And that is because Satan, amen, has persuaded them here. That's what we've been talking about. Satan has persuaded them, amen, to go this way and think this way. He's got this world programmed to think a completely different way than the Word of God tells us to think. But thank God tonight, hallelujah, there is still a power, praise God, that runs this world and that walks this world and this earth. Hallelujah, there is still a power that is inside of us, praise God. And we know the truth, and we know who the truth is. If we can just get them to be enlightened to who the truth really is, amen, it'll still set those free, praise God, that live and dwell in darkness. It'll still set those free who are believing lies tonight and going to hell for it. But it's up to you and I, praise God, to be persuasive in the Word like we've never been before. Amen. Satan is working overtime, and praise God, he's doing a very good job tonight at getting people to turn their ears away from the truth and unto a fable. Praise God, I've got something here tonight in my hands, hallelujah. It's been persuading people for 2,000 years, praise God, to give their life over unto Jesus Christ. It's done it back then. It done it for me. It done it for you. And it will still do it, praise God, if we only lift up the bloodstained banner. Come on, you ain't hearing me tonight. You've got a great duty in front of you. I've got a great duty in front of me. People are dying and going to hell right now. Praise God, it's up to you and I, hallelujah, to get the truth out and to let them know there is another way. You don't have to go the way of the world. You don't have to be persuaded by Satan and the enemy, praise God. But there's a place eternal in the heavens made with God's hands, hallelujah. One of these days, that's going to be my final destination. You love them, raise your hands and praise them. Hallelujah. We beseech you, and listen, there's a lot of things that people try to use, listen to me, to persuade other people to believe a certain thing or to go a certain way. Now watch what Paul uses here. My brethren, I beseech you, or I'm trying to implore you, or I am trying to persuade you by what? By the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, what a thing to be persuaded by. Do you hear me? What a thing to be persuaded by. And we know the world's got its methods and Satan's got his methods, but I like Brother Paul's right here. I'm going to persuade you by this one thing. If this doesn't persuade you, I don't know what will. If this doesn't make you, praise God, turn your back and come to God, I don't know what will. If this doesn't persuade you, I believe you're beyond helping. I'm going to persuade you, hallelujah, by the coming of our Lord and Savior. Let this persuade you, amen. Let this empower you that Jesus is coming and we're going to be gathered unto him. My God, is that of persuasion tonight or not, hallelujah. It's persuaded me a long time ago, praise God, and it's still persuading me tonight, praise God, to live right, amen, to do the right thing and to serve God if nobody else wants to do it. I'm persuaded, hallelujah, by the coming of our Lord, good God Almighty. I'd never looked at it like that before. Never read it like that before. Here's what he's saying, folks. Right? I beseech you. I'm going to beg you. I'm going to persuade you by one thing. By the coming of our Lord Jesus and by our gathering together unto him. Now, what does that sound like to you? Hallelujah. Good God Almighty, if that doesn't persuade you to live right and do the right thing, then I don't know what will tonight. How many of you really truly tonight? How many of you really truly have the longing to go be with the Lord? How many of you really, I mean truly? The older you get, brethren, Brother Jimmy, the older I get, nothing else seems to matter. The older I get, you know, and the things that I used to like and things that I used to draw pleasure in, they just don't matter anymore. There's not that drawing anymore, amen? Listen, our life, as everybody in here knows, is very fragile. It can change just like that. It can turn and change, and you'll never be the same just like that. Amen. Learn to enjoy the blessings of God that he has blessed you with today, amen, because there is no promise that you will have it tomorrow. There's no promise you will have somebody in your life tomorrow. So praise God and thank God that you have it today while you have it. Lots of folks in here, and we've all got loved ones who's passed on. Next time we see them, we'll be over in glory. Amen. Hallelujah. I beseech you, amen, or let me persuade you, amen, by this also that there is a great day of reunion that awaits us all. Hallelujah. There's a great reunion day. Praise God. One of these days, hallelujah, praise God, we're going to see everyone that died in the faith. Praise God. They're just waiting on our getting there. They're just waiting on us and our journey to be over with them. And I don't believe it's going to be too awfully long. And I don't care which way I got to do it. If I got to go by way of the grave, then so be it. Amen. But I don't look for the grave. I don't believe that's the way it's going to be, because I'm persuaded with the feeling inside of me that this is going to be the final generation that sees the coming of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. If you believe it tonight, then lift your hands like you believe it. Praise God tonight like you believe it. Listen, we're heaven bound, folks. I said we're heaven bound. When the trump of God sounds, we are out of here. Hallelujah. I beseech you, or let me persuade you by our gathering together unto him. If that does not persuade you, if that does not spur you on, amen, if that doesn't do anything for you, then I would probably gather around this altar and pray. And I'm just being honest with you. Talk to folks all the time. Well, I'm in no hurry. Listen, if I could have my choice tonight, I would tonight that this would be the very night that the Lord comes and calls us home. Amen. I would tonight that the trumpet of God would sound. Amen. That the dead in Christ would arise. And all of us, praise God, would be changed at the moment in the twinkling of an eye. Hallelujah. This world is not my home. Amen. I'm only passing through. My treasures are laid up somewhere beyond the blue. Hallelujah. My Lord, they don't write them like that anymore. Hallelujah. Paul's doing his best to do a persuasion using the Lord and using the gathering. Amen. And I think that's a lesson we can all learn. That's something we can all learn from what Brother Paul did here. Hey, do you want to come to the house of God? Amen. Do you want to be with God's people? Amen. Do you want to gather with God's people? Amen. Do you want to get a glimpse, praise God, when the power of God comes down? Do you want to get a little glimpse of what it's going to be like, praise God, when we get over into the other side for all of eternity? Amen. We just see in part now. We know in part. We think in part. Amen. You just see a little glimpse of it. Amen. Some of the best services that we've ever been in our lives, that's just a drop in the bucket compared to what it's going to be like, amen, when you finally get into the presence of God Almighty. Hallelujah. You love them, raise your hands. How many times have we daydreamed, brethren, about what it's going to finally feel like when we look upon the face, praise God, of the one who died for us? Hallelujah. One of these days, it's going to become reality, amen. One of these days, praise God, our faith is going to end in sight. By our gathering together unto him, and here's what he was shooting for. Here's the persuasion. That ye be not soon shaken in mind. Look, gives a list here. Or be troubled. Now listen, there's a difference in being shaken and troubled. Amen. Hear a loud boom or something in the middle of the night, that'll shake you up for a couple minutes. There's a difference in being shaken than being troubled. Amen. I've seen people, I've been there, you know, I'm honest with you. You know, I go through things too. I'm not exempt from anything, if anything, a little bit more. I heard Brother Powell say one time, he said a minister's trial and things that he goes through is far different than everybody else's. Didn't recognize it at the time, but now I do. And being troubled is different from being shaken. Shaken, hey, you can shake it off if you're troubled. How many of you seen people are just constantly wore down, constantly troubled, constantly fighting something in their mind, constantly battling something in their spirit? That is trouble. Constantly troubled. David said, troubled waters have come in unto my soul. When troubled waters hit your soul, you've got serious problems. There's only one that can deliver you out of that. Amen. How many of you know what it's been like? How many of you ever been troubled? It's a bad feeling. It really is. Amen. Being shaken's bad. Amen. But being troubled is far worse. Amen. You can't rest day or night when you beg to fall asleep so you can quit thinking about something while you're asleep. But as soon as you wake up, it smacks you right back in the face again. Amen. Say amen. You're right, Brother Mike. You know exactly. You know exactly what I'm talking about. That is being troubled. But Paul is using a different method of persuasion here for you to not be shaken. Amen. For you to not be troubled. Amen. He's saying, I want you to remember this one thing. Let me persuade you by this. Amen. That one of these days, You're going to be with the Lord forevermore. We're all going to be gathered unto him. Why worry about the things that are just temporary? Because Paul said, for I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not even worthy to be compared to the glory that shall be revealed in us tonight. Hallelujah. Just think about that. The sufferings of this present time. Sometimes they get bad according to this flesh. Paul said, the glory and everything that awaits us over yonder are not even worthy to be compared in the same sentence with. He puts a distinction in it. And he's saying this. I don't want you to be shaken in mind. I don't want you to be troubled, neither by spirit, your spirit, anybody else's spirit, a bad spirit, nor by word. Words have a way of troubling you. Words have a way of shaking you. But Paul's saying this. There is a way, amen, that you can live in peace. There is a way, praise God, that you can live in perfect harmony, amen. If there wasn't, he would have never pointed you the direction, amen, that he is mapping out for us here, hallelujah. And that persuasion and that way is, listen, I've been down, you've been down, but praise God, I start thinking about what it's going to be like. Praise God, when this life is past, I start thinking about what it's going to be like. Praise God, when my feet touch the streets of gold, I start thinking what it's going to be like, praise God, when I'm walking through that city, praise God, when I'm looking at the folks of old, when I'm looking at, praise God, Brother Paul and Brother Peter, and one of these days, praise God, what it's finally going to feel like, hallelujah, when I see the one, praise God, who made it all possible. I'm talking about Jesus. I'm talking to one I've been preaching about for the last 25 years. I'm talking about the one, praise God, who's been saving people for the last 2,000 years. I'm talking about Jesus tonight. Hallelujah. So Paul is showing us a way that you don't have to be troubled, that you don't have to be bothered, amen, by word or spirit or anything else. What he's saying, I want you to think about the day. Let me persuade you and show you a way out of your trouble. Amen. Think about what it's going to be like when we're all gathered together. Amen. What it's going to be like, hallelujah, one of these days when he wipes away all the tears from our eyes. What it's going to be like, praise God. I don't know about you, but I'm getting excited right now just thinking, hallelujah, what it's going to be like one of these days when that great reunion takes place over in the glory land, hallelujah. It's not going to be too awfully long, but praise God, I want you to know we're going to celebrate for all of eternity, praise God, when we finally cross over. Hallelujah. Lift your hands tonight. Close your eyes. Let's worship the Lord just for a minute here tonight. Hallelujah. Let it persuade you tonight. If you're troubled in your spirit, don't be tonight. If you're shaken tonight, don't be, because Jesus is coming. I said Jesus is coming. My God, don't let anything else drag you down, but be uplifted and encouraged tonight. Be persuaded by his coming and our gathering together unto him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. You just wish that sometimes, you know, I just wish we could take what we know to be truth and in fact and, you know, just plug in like a computer and just download it into other people. Wouldn't that be nice? Wouldn't that be easy? Praise God, that's where the Holy Ghost comes in, amen. Let him download it into somebody. Come on, you know what I'm talking about tonight, amen. One preaches, one waters, another plants, but praise God, God will give the increase, amen. You put the word out there, and the Holy Ghost will download it into their spirit. Let them know they've got a need for a Savior, and let them know, praise God, that there is only one way. Hallelujah. Let's all stand tonight. I'm going to end it right there. Come on back up, Sister Judy. Hallelujah. We hope and trust that you've got something out of this tonight, and that's what we always pray. It's we always ask the Lord, God, give us something, a sentence, a phrase, a scripture, something that's going to help somebody tonight along their journey. Hallelujah. And every head bowed and every eye closed. Heavenly Father, as she plays, Lord, we thank you tonight, Lord, for the words of eternal life. We thank you, God, for the life that they've given us. Lord, we pray tonight that something's been done and something's been said, Lord, and an impression's been made upon everyone here, upon those that'll watch and will watch, Lord, from your word. Lord, that's going to persuade them, Lord, of their need for a Savior. Lord, that there's no need to worry, no need to take thought for tomorrow will take thought for itself. Lord, help us to be empowered by the thought, knowing that soon and very soon, Lord, you're going to call us away to be with you forevermore. As she sings and as she plays, tonight, if you need
there's a
prayer,
city of
or anything,
where they're coming,
I want you to come up front.
No night.
I'm going to have prayer for you.
For the
have
sun
a time of prayer.
Never
believe
sets
the Lord will touch you. Anybody, anywhere,
sky.
Need prayer. If you don't,
in the Bible,
let's sing and worship alone as Sister Judy plays and sings.
That the streets are pure gold. And a cool, gentle river runs by.
Let's worship them all over.
I'm bound for that city, God's
holy
white city.
Thank you, Lord.
Oh, yes, I am. I'll never turn back into this world anymore.
Thank you, Jesus.
No matter how rough may be the way, no matter how oft I stop to pray, I'm bound for that city on the evergreen shore. Little children will play, and our hearts will be gay as we stroll through that city of gold. No more dying up there, no more sorrow to bear, and nobody will be feeble and old. I'm bound for that city, God's holy white city. Oh, yes, I am. I'll never turn back into this world anymore. No matter how rough may be the way, no matter how oft I stop to pray, I'm bound for that city on the evergreen shore.
Amen. Brother Weber said he wanted to say something tonight, so.
About, let's see, it's been over 50-some years ago. And I'm standing back there listening to brother preach. And then it hit me. How can you leave here when you're a preacher yourself and not say what God wants you to say? You got to say it. I was standing back there, and 50-some years ago, it may be a plus or minus a few years, I was a young Christian at 29 years old, had just gotten saved. And I had a bad habit and was smoking. And you say, you know. But that's a bad habit. It stinks, and it'll kill you.
Yeah.
And I remember going in my pocket. I had a habit. I carried those little Muriel cigars in there and a pack of cigarettes, and I chewed, spit, all that kind of stuff. You know, I had just gotten saved, and I remember getting in my pocket, and a voice in the back of my head said, if you let me, I could deliver you from those things. That was God talking to me. I took those things out of my pocket and went like this to throw them away, and someone, I don't know who it was, came by, took them out of my hands, and he was gone. From that day to this, I've never had another desire to smoke. It was gone. Everything was gone. And God started cleaning me up. And for the past 50-some years, as a brother said, I've been in places, it's terrible. And you get weary of it. You get weary of getting beat up. And you come to the place, I can't take it anymore. And you start giving in. But God has a way to get you. He's got a way to reach down. And I, standing back there, I was thinking of all the marvelous places and the marvelous things that God did with my life when he took that pack of stinkies out of my hand. And that's right, out of my lips. So anyway, I didn't give it too much thought till this past week, and it's been a battle. You say it's over, but it isn't. You gotta keep going. I like that scripture in the book of Revelation that God detests cowards. And just keep going. But anyway, I want to get to this to tell you. Just today, my wife came over and talked to me, said she's been worried. I had tests taken over a gallbladder. And I said, gallbladder, I haven't felt anything. I'm doing all right. I don't feel any hurts or any of those things. What's it supposed to be? Well, we had to take tests, and was up at the hospital. And I think the Russians sent that tester up there to aggravate us, because that was the most aggravating test I had ever taken in my life. And, it just was plain aggravating. And so they said, well, somebody's got to read it, and they got to get a doctor in here, and they got to do this. Well, I knew ahead of time that the one doctor says, passing by, he said, I saw your x-rays. And he said, he mentioned something about cancer. Well, I had worked around asbestos for I don't know how many years as a young man, as a young machinist, and knocking asbestos off of pipes and off of turbines and all that stuff. And I knew what he was talking about. There's been a lot of people died from asbestosis. Because once that asbestos gets in your lungs and takes a hook, it's a death sentence for you. There's no ifs, ands, and buts. They can do whatever they want to do. They probably have, the best thing to do is take your whole lung out and throw it away. And they just don't do that. Some of us just don't go on. And I wasn't going to say anything tonight. I said, no. But, you know, we owe it to God. When God does something for us, we owe it. And how many people throughout the 50 years that I've ministered got up and testified of what God did for them? And here I am back there keeping my big mouth shut when I should be telling people. And so anyway, my wife gets a call tonight. And she said, your tests came back, and they were waiting. I knew what they were waiting for when I first took it, they saw that asbestosis. And anyway, I knew what she was talking about. I knew what they were talking about because I kept questioning them. And I was kidding my wife the other day. I said, you know, I may make you $290,000 richer. Because that's what they give you when you're passing away and you have had asbestosis. And there was a friend of mine that was in his service. It's a lawyer down in Florida. He always kept sending flyers to me about it. And so, you know, that was there. And I know what my wife was meaning tonight. They said they didn't see anything. They didn't see a thing. And I said to her, I said, what are they going to do? She said, well, they're waiting on a doctor to come in now. The guy that takes care of the gallbladder, I guess he's the one that has to pull it out. And that's the problem that it was. It may not be, you know, you might say, well, it's not that much to get excited about. Yes, it is. Because way back then, 50-some years ago, God saw. You know, God sees you. God knows what it is. And I thought, what a... I come in a service here, and I enjoy it. I enjoy hearing the preaching. And I said to my wife today as I was going out, I said, you know, hon, there's times that I preached to over 400 and some people. I've preached in a good part of this world. And we were talking about finances. We never worried about finances. God always took care of that. Yeah, he took care of us. And somebody said, well, you always tell stories, Brother Weber. Yeah, God gave me these stories to tell. I can remember it in London. We were standing at Piccadilly the other day. The film was going on and they were shooting some film in this one movie. I said, honey, there's Piccadilly. You and I were there. We had our two little kids with us. We had the other kids were home, but our two kids were with us. And Therese says to me, she said, where are we going to spend the night? And I said, you know what? I don't have the slightest idea where we're going to be tonight. And that before I would, when I walked away from where, somebody walked up to her and said to her, sister, you don't have a place to go tonight with your kids. He says, I'll provide a place for you. And my wife said, well, I got to go ask my husband about that. I said, you tell him we're coming. Anyway, we took the two kids with us. And this man and his wife were on a wealthy side. And a lot of, you know, a lot of our life, and you sit there and say, well, you just sometimes you feel like you're poor as a church mouse. And you're not. You say, well, I don't have that much. We could tell you how much we didn't have. And sometimes we just thought we had to do away with some meals and things like that. But God always provided. God always took care of us. And I got to watch my wife because if I'm not careful, she'll even give me away. She's constantly giving away. And I said, hon, look, come on. This stuff's got to stop. And... that's the way it is when you're poor. But God never forgets. He never forgets. And when you think about it, you never went hungry. You know what hunger is? You never went hungry. There's a lot of us went through hunger. We know what it is. And we could tell you about it. But the great thing is this, that God gives it back to you. That saying, somebody else says, you can't outgive God. Now, I like to get out on a road out there and tell you, you can't outgive God. He'll give it back to you one way or the other. And it's great when he does, and it's great when he doesn't. And you're saying, well, I'm looking around a congregation here. It's not many people here. And that's they're not benefiting. They're not benefiting from this service. What our brother was saying, there's a lot of truth. And a lot of the truth that he was saying tonight brought me up down that aisle. I couldn't no more go home tonight and not say anything than anyone else. It would be a sin. All he's done for me, and my wife tells me a lot of times that, she says, you know, you're selfish. And that's nice to hear all the time. I'm selfish, right? All God's done for you, which is the truth. Well, yeah, where can East Baltimore boy, uneducated, didn't know anything, and come to know how God could take your life and move you around this globe without any big organizations. You see these guys on TV, they're griping because they don't have more than one jet to fly around in. They're griping because they don't have not just one mansion, two mansions or more. And it's going to come back to them. They're going to pay the price for that. They're going to pay the price for that. And they're, you could sit down. You know, I see his sister getting fidgety on the back of the pew. But you could sit down and relax. I'm almost finished. And I know that a lot of times, being a minister, don't drag them all out and ring them out. Give them a chance to sit down and enjoy yourselves. We might never get another chance like a service like this. And if you would take everything that you've heard and you've put it together, and the next time, like myself, you feel like I'm quitting, what are you going to do when you quit? Where are you going? I've had God tell me that. I quit. I can remember as a young Christian, I had it, really had it. And I hadn't been through anything yet. But I had it. And I quit. And I used a little bit of a off-colored word when I said that. And I threw myself on a bed. And there was a voice said to me, well, boy, that's what he called me. God called me boy. Well, boy, where are you going from here? And I thought about it, what he brought me out of. I could have lost my life a number of times and wound up in hell. Where are you going to go from here? That's what he said. Where are you going to go from here? And I rolled back out off that bed and got on my knees because there was no place to go. And every so often, God has a way. And you wonder, why do you go to church on a Thursday night? What are you, nuts? But if it wasn't for the brother here saying a few things that he said, I'd still be wallowing around in my self-pity. And that's why we have service. God has these places to pick us up, to keep us going. You're a chosen generation, a royal priesthood. And that's what you are. You're somebody. Many of us will never probably have our own private jets. Yeah, but got to get us around. Got to get us there. First, and I'll tell you, I spent a lot of time in Haiti. And it's a place that sometimes you could just sit down and cry. When you can see it, you sit down and cry. Amen. What these people have to go through. I can remember, and I'm going to quit with this. We were there over to one of the holidays and getting ready to leave. And the people wanted to give us something. They wanted to feed us before we go. And they wanted to give us something to eat. And I remember seeing all these sandwiches sitting there. And I picked one up and took a bite out of it. Well, the bite went down so far, and it just wouldn't go any further. Because I know that those people took the last penny they had to give us Americans that didn't know any hunger, give us something to eat before we left. And that did, let me tell you something, that'd do something to you. And I think in this country, it's coming. It's coming. I know what it is to see my family. We have the pictures in a restaurant. My family, that us kids, when we sit around a table, and they would take the food, and you could see them. And I never forgot that. I was 14 years old when I watched them. They'd take the food and slide it towards us kids. And I thought that was strange. But they wanted to make sure us kids didn't go hungry, and they were hungry. What a blessing we have to be a Christian. There's a lot of us, and there's a lot of people, give up. We all come close to giving up. We all come, and God doesn't hold that over us. It's a learning experience that he could take us through. And every service should be a learning experience for us. We come here for what? Just to have somebody try to pump us up? To go to the next stop? It's much more than that. It's much more. You try sometime. Try sometime getting the mind of God and get up in front of people and minister to them. It's not the easiest thing to do. Yeah, there's go to some of the churches. That's enough to take the air out of your balloon. When one of the head deacons comes out and says, "Hey, brother, we turned the lights out at 8 o'clock. You better be finished." Mm-hmm. Well, that make you feel good. Mm-hmm. And he wasn't lying either. 8 o'clock came along, and he had to switch it. You could see the lights going off. Made you feel real good. And you wondered, "Lord, where's your presence?" You don't know where their presence is, or, you know, when they turn the lights off and put God in the dark. Mm-hmm. I've been in churches or in parts of England, in Rossington, it brings it back to my mind where the pastor in that area, Therese and I, we left Wales and we went to Rossington for meetings. And the pastor in that town said, "Brother Weber, we got a problem here." And I said, "What's that?" He says, "The people are always calling me. They're seeing little things at the window." You know what they were seeing. They were seeing demons hanging out at the window, and they're always calling me there. So I thought, well, sometimes when you're in these places, you think that the ministers or the people are nuts when they tell you these things. Well, but they're not. They're very real to them. And I'll tell you this story just and then I'll quit. There was church, like maybe a little bigger than this, and the pastor says to me, there's a two groups of young men and young women came in and filled up two pews. And they were loud, disrespectful, and everything else. And the pastor said, Brother Weber, and he was apologizing. He said, every time we have service, they come in here and they disrupt our service. And it was demonic. And what are you gonna do? They're sitting in a pews and they're carrying on and they're loud. And I looked around, I said, wait a minute. We ain't gonna let the devil kick us around. And I got my eye on one guy there. And he seemed like he was the ringleader of the whole thing. And service went on, and I said, we just can't have that. And I called him up from the middle of all his buddies and everything. I just went like this. Come on up here. I want to talk to you. I brought him up, and I guess that's the way my nature. I said something before in the church when I did that, and I got him up, put my arm around him, and I said, you know, son, I said, in about 5 minutes, I'm going to be getting up there in that pulpit, and I'm going to be preaching. And I'm going to tell you this. If I see you and your buddies carrying on here, I'm going to come down out of that pulpit, and I'm going to thrash the living daylights out of you. Well, I know it's not orthodox, and so anyway, I went up there and preached, and there wasn't a sound made. It was the best altar call that I had ever given in my whole life, because when I had finished preaching, the people in the congregation came running up, and they wanted to know, what did you tell that kid? And I didn't tell him anything. But that kid knew. And anyway, we went on with the service, and the service was over. And I often thought about that. That I told them the truth. This is what I told. And this is sometimes when a devil starts picking on us, we let him do it. And we don't answer back. God give us the power. Listen, he said, I'm going to give you power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you. And if we let the devil push us around and let people push us around just because we're Christians, there's something wrong with us. We forgot where we came from. And I could remember that through the years, where God gives us that power to get up, and just like tonight, Weber, don't go up there and make a fool out of yourself. So there's somebody here sitting in this congregation, you need help. And a brother was saying it, you need help. And my advice to you, you're here, you go get that help. And right now, I'm going to sit down. You get up out of that pew if you need some help. Come on down here. It's just what the scripture says. I beseech you, I beg you, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present yourself a living sacrifice. He says, I beseech you. And so it's up to you. Don't sit there or you're not going to get any deliverance. Walk up. Do it. People will think, what do you think they're going to think about me? Listen, if I'm drowning, I don't care what you're thinking about me. I need somebody to pull you up. It's like this service tonight. I need that. I need a lot of forgiveness for what went through my head and through my mind, because that's the only way he could get you is through your head. And you think about it, and you entertain what he usually wants to get you with. And you entertain that back in your head, and you think there's something wrong with you. There's nothing wrong with you. That's right. You're perfectly safe. You're safe in the arms of God. He's not going to let you go. Why do you think he saved you? To lose you? We may not. You say, well, I'm not worth it. You are worth it. He died for you. And listen, I think back, it's been a great life. It's been a great life, and I guess I've preached for, I don't know, now 50 years, the detention center, and that's a thrill in itself. And I hear people talking in this kind of, like they talk to the devil. You don't want to talk to the devil. You don't want anything to do with him. You don't want to give him an answer. Like at the detention center, I walked down at one of the tiers one day and, hey, chap, I hear this voice say, hey, chap, how about getting me a satanic Bible? And my answer to him was, I don't know what you want one of those things for. You're right where you're at now. Is worse than probably in hell. Because no human being should be locked up in a cage. And so it's a bad place to be. Anyway, I got to sit down. I'll keep on going. But I love doing evangelistic work. I've loved preaching. Teresa and I, we'd go down there and $7 in our pockets. I go back to the money. Everybody thought right away, how much is it going to cost me? We operated on around $7. And we never went hungry and never did without. Brother, I'm going to sit down before I take an offering for you.
Amen. Amen. Hey, glad we could help inspire someone tonight. Amen. Give Brother Weber a hand. Let's all stand. Yeah. Amen. Glad we could help somebody out there. Let's close in prayer tonight. Amen. Brother Jimmy, would you close us in prayer tonight?